Shoda nanda na raja jana ranjana. Yamuna tira vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kuncha Vihari. Jaya Vishnupad Paramahamsa Parvajakacharya Asatar Sata Sri Sri Madhis Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada Ki Jai. Ananta Koti Vaishnavrinda Ki Jai. ISKCON Founder Acharya Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Grantaraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai. Gaur Premananda. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 9, Chapter 11, Lord Ramachandra Rules the World, Text 20. Nedam Yasho Raghupate Surayachnayata Lila Tanor Adika Samya Vimukta Damnaha Rakshovado Jaladi Bandhanam Astrapugai Kim Tasya Satruhanane Kapaya Sahayaha. Nedam yasho raghupate surayachnayata. Lila tanur adhika samya vimukta damnaha. Raksho vado jaladi bandhanam astrapugai. Kim tasya satruhana ne kapaya sahayaha. Nedam yasho raghupate surayachnayata. Lila tanur adhika samya vimukta damnaha. Raksho vado jaladi bandhanam astrapugai. Kim tasya satruhanane kapaya sahayaha. Nedam yasho raghupate surayachnayata. Lila Tanur Adika Samya Vimukta Damna. Raksho Vado Jalabdi Pandanam Astra Plugai. Kim Tasya Shatru Hanane Kapaya Sahayaha. Kam Yasha Raghupate Sarayatsnayata. Ila Tandur Adhika Samya Vimukta Dhamna. Paksha Vado Jalabhi Bandhana Mastra Pugai. Shavada Chalabdi Kandana Matsapugai. Kim Tasya Satru Halane Kapiya Sahayaha. Nedam Yashoragupate Surayatsnayata. Lila Tanur Adhika Samya Vimukta Dhamna. Raksha Vada Jalabhi Bandhana Mastra Pugai. Kim Tasya Satru Hanane Kapaya Sahayaha. Nedam Yasha Raghupate Surayatsnayata.
Vaishnavis.
Nedam Yasha Raghupate Surayatsnayata. Lila Tanur Adhika Samya Vimukta Dhamnaha. Raksha Vado Jaladi Bandhana Mastra Pugahai. Kim Tasya Satru Hanane Kapaya Sahayaha. Nedam Yasha Raghupate Surayatsnayata. Lila Tanur Adhika Samya Vimukta Dhamnaha. Sahayaha. Nedam yasho raghupate surayachnayata. Lilatanor adhika samya vimukta dhamnaha. Aksha varo chalabdi bandana mastra prugai. Kim tasya satru hanane kapeya sahaya. Na, not, idam, all these, yashaha, fame, raghupatehe, of Lord Ramachandra, surayachnaya, by the prayers of the demigods, atalilatanoho, whose spiritual body is always engaged in various pastimes. Adhika samya vimukta dhamnaha. No one is greater than or equal to him. Rakshavadaha. Killing the Rakshasa. Ravana, Jaladi Bandhanam, bridging the ocean, Astrapugahai, with bow and arrows, Kim, weather, Tasya, his, Satruhanane, in killing the enemies. Kapayaha, the monkeys, Sahayaha, assistance, translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Lord Ramachandra's reputation for having killed Ravana with showers of arrows at the request of the demigods and for having built a bridge over the ocean does not constitute the factual glory of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Ramachandra, whose spiritual body is always engaged in various pastimes. Lord Ramachandra has no equal or superior, and therefore he had no need to take help from the monkeys to gain victory over Ravana. Please repeat. Lord Ramachandra's reputation for having killed Ravana with showers of arrows at the request of the demigods and for having built a bridge over the ocean does not constitute the factual glory of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Lord Ramachandra, whose spiritual body is always engaged in various pastimes. Lord Ramachandra has no equal or superior, and therefore he had no need to take help from the monkeys to gain victory over Ravana. Purport. As stated in the Vedas, Shvetashvatara Upanishad 6.8, Natasya karyam karanam cha vidyate, natat shamas cha vyadikas cha drishyate, parashya shaktir vividai vashruyate, swabhaviki jnana balakriya cha. Quote, the Supreme Lord has nothing to do and no one is found to be equal to or greater than him. For everything is done naturally and systematically by his multifarious energies." End quote. The Lord has nothing to do, natasya karyam karanam cha vidyate. Whatever he does is his pastime. The Lord has no duty to perform to oblige anyone. Nonetheless, he appears to act to protect his devotees or kill his enemies. Of course, no one can be the Lord's enemy, since who could be more powerful than the Lord? There's actually no question of anyone's being his enemy, but when the Lord wants to take pleasure in pastimes, he comes down to this material world and acts like a human being, thus showing his wonderful, glorious activities to please the devotees. His devotees always want to see the Lord victorious in varied activities, and therefore, to please himself and them, the Lord sometimes agrees to act as a human being and perform wonderful, uncommon pastimes for the satisfaction of the devotees. Om Jnana Timurandasya Gananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Militanyena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasudhi Gaur Bhaktivinoda Hare Krishna Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare. So in this purport, Srila Prabhupada quotes this verse from the Svet Ashvatara Upanishad, Natasya Karyam Karanam Cha Vidyate, Natat Samascha Vidkastra Drishyate, Parashya Shaktir Vividai Vashruyate, Swabhaviki Jnana Bala Kriya Cha. And it's a verse that Srila Prabhupada quotes many, many times in his books and lectures and letters. So we'll consider in detail what it means. First line is Natasya Karyam Karanam Cha Vidyate. And Srila Prabhupada translates that as the Supreme Lord has nothing to do. In other words, he has no duty that he has to perform for the sake of someone else. He's totally independent. Ishvara Parama Krishna. Krishna is the supreme controller. There's nobody who is his equal or superior. Therefore, he doesn't have to do anything for anyone else's sake. He acts solely for his own pleasure. He doesn't need to do anything. So, everyone else is in the position of having some superior. Everyone else is in the position of having to do something, being forced to do something for out of obligation somehow or other. It's like, you know, Srila Prabhupada was saying once that Krishna doesn't have anything to do. He's simply enjoying with Radharani. And he said, we have the same tendency. We want to enjoy with our Radharani, but if we don't work, then we starve to death. So everyone else besides Krishna has to do some duty. Yeah, we see, that people in this world, they are in a position where they have some superior. If they're young and they're in school, then they have their teachers and professors at the university and what they say they have to do. you know, if they want to get their degrees and graduate, you know, they have to satisfy their superiors. They have to come to class. They have to pay their tuition. They have to take out loans, and then they're obligated to repay their loans. You know, they have to work to do that, to repay their student loans. So, and then if they graduate, you know, then, you know, they seek some employment, and then they have some boss that they have to satisfy in order to get the money that they need to live their lives. Or, you know, even if they decide, well, I'm going to be my own boss, I'm going to start some business, then, you know, they have to apply for a business license in the city that they live in. They have to pay some tax to the city. They have to pay some tax to the state. They have to pay some tax to the federal government. There are so many rules and regulations that they have to follow. There are building inspectors. If they're running a restaurant, there are restaurant inspectors. So, you know, everyone has to be subject to the authority of someone else in this world. But Krishna is not subject to anyone else's authority by his nature. Ekala Ishvara Krishna Arasabha Britya. Krishna is the supreme controller. All others are his servants, even his fully empowered expansions, like, you know, Balaram, and his energies like Radharani. Actually, they're all his servants. Now, this is explained very nicely by Krishna Das Kaviraj in the Chaitanya Charitamrita, how all these different categories of living beings, even Krishna's expansions, see themselves as his servants. Of course, Krishna, for his pleasure, can agree to take a subordinate role if he wants to do that. If he wants to enter into a loving relationship with the devotee who plays the role of his mother, Mother Yashoda, he can do that. And then his mother chastises him, his mother tells him to do this or that, and he does. Not because he has to or is being forced to, but simply to maintain that kind of loving relationship. But in principle, ontologically, Krishna has no duty. And because we are part and parcel of Krishna, we have the same tendency, you know, that we want to have no duty, no feeling of being compelled that we have to do something. And in Bhagavad Gita, Krishna states this. It's in chapter 3, text 17. There's one verse that states, in almost the same language that's used in relationship to Krishna, it's stated in relationship to spirit souls who are devotees of Krishna. Tasya karyam na vidyate. And that verse states, for one who is totally absorbed and taking pleasure from the self, not the self with a little s, but self with a big S, a capital S, in other words, Krishna. For one who is totally absorbed in Krishna consciousness, taking pleasure from his relationship with the Supreme Self, there is no duty. And in the purport, Srila Prabhupada explains that when one becomes fully Krishna conscious, one's duty is illuminated from within. It isn't imposed externally. Of course, when we're in the position of identifying with the material mind and body, you know, we do have to accept duties under the instruction of Krishna's representative, the bona fide spiritual master. We are given things to do and not to do, which we are obligated to do, because ultimately we're meant to be servants of Krishna. Jivara Sarupa Hoy, Krishnara Nitya Das, that's the eternal constitutional position of every soul, to be the servant of Krishna, engaged in Krishna's devotional service. But before we come to the stage of spontaneous devotional service, we have to engage in Vaidhi Bhakti, or devotional service in practice according to rules and regulations, where we do things under authority. But in that verse from Bhagavad Gita and in the purport, Srila Prabhupada is explaining, if somebody becomes totally Krishna conscious and they understand completely, I am not this body, I am not this mind, I am pure spirit soul, engaged in my eternal loving relationship with the Supreme Personality of Godhead, then the duty for that person, it's naturally and spontaneously coming from the self. But as long as we're identifying with the mind and the body, we have, you know, duties, you know, that we're obliged to perform. So, in a sense, even for the devotee of the Lord in the ultimate state, there is no duty, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. But in this verse from the Shvetashvatara Upanishad, this is being applied to Krishna and his position as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, with no one superior or equal to him. So the spirit souls, like Krishna, they are also eternal. Mamaivamso jivaloke jivabhuta sanatana. Krishna explains in the Bhagavad Gita, the souls are part and parcel of me, and like me, they are eternal, sanatana. And that means they are beyond birth and death. Actually, the other day I had to go to the dentist. That proves I'm not God. Srila Prabhupada would joke around like that. He says, so many people are claimed to be God, but then they get a toothache and they have to go to the dentist. So what kind of God is that? So I was having a little philosophical discussion with a dentist who was cleaning my teeth. He was scraping the plaque off the teeth with these sharp metal instruments, and he was saying, you know, it's really amazing how there are so many types of living entities in the world. Just like on your teeth, there are these germs, and they're forming this plaque, and here I am, I'm killing them. That seems to be a feature of life in this world, death. I said, well, really you're not killing the germs, you're just moving them from one place to another. You're scraping them off my teeth and you're putting them over in your trash can. He said, no, they're going to die because they live off all the organic material in your mouth and on your teeth. So if I take them out of that environment, which is the environment in which they're meant to survive, they are going to die. They're going to starve. I said, well, yeah, that's right. But, you know, you have to understand that any type of body, whether it's the body of a bacterium or the body of a plant or the body of an animal or the body of anything, is a vehicle for a soul. And that soul is eternal. It's not subject to birth and death. So it'll just go, you know, if its body dies, it will go somewhere else. So he was comforted by that. You know, he was worried he was killing so many millions of bacterium. So the soul is eternal, and it's the eternal servant of Krishna, and Krishna is supreme, and he has no duties that he has to do. So, natatshamas chavridikastu drishite, we've discussed that. Krishna doesn't have any equal or superior, unless he agrees out of his own free will for the purpose of his lila or pastimes to play the role of having, you know, being subject to the authority or desire of someone. Like he agrees to be the beloved of Radharani, and Radharani says this or that, he does it. Or his mother Yashoda tells him to do something and he does it. But that's his free will for his pastimes. Parashya Shaktir Vividaiva Shruyate. Krishna has various energies. Swabhaviki Jnana Bala Kriya Cha. And these energies carry out his activities for him in three areas: Jnana, Bala, and Kriya. So to carry out any activity successfully, you need these three things: Jnana, Bala, and Kriya. Jnana means knowledge. If you're going to perform some activity, you have to know what you're doing. If you don't know what you're doing, your activity is not going to be successful. And not only do you need knowledge, you need bala. Bala means the strength or the power or the energy to accomplish the task that you're going to do. And then kriya means you have to have the ability to convert that power or energy into the practical activities that are necessary for you to carry out your purpose. So many times we see that people in this world are not able to carry out their activities because they don't have sufficient knowledge, they don't have sufficient strength, and they're not expert enough to perform the necessary activities. And therefore, people are very frustrated in this material world because, for the most part, they are not always successful in their carrying out their planned activities, at least to the extent they would like to be able to carry things out. You know, people are able to do something, but not as much as they'd like, or as easily as they'd like, or with the expense they would like to carry out their activities. And this happens swabhaviki for Krishna, automatically. He doesn't have to make any effort. He doesn't have to make any effort. And Srila Prabhupada would often give examples of, say, like a wealthy person, like in Birla, in India, there were wealthy people that he knew, like the Birlas and the Tatas. And he would say, you know, Mr. Birla has so many factories, but it's not that Mr. Birla is running around in each factory directly, you know, running things. It's his factory, but if you look in the factory, you won't see Mr. Birla. Mr. Birla is sitting somewhere in his office, apparently not doing anything, but so many things are going on under his direction. He has so many secretaries and assistants and managers and workers who are under his ultimate authority, and they're carrying everything out without too much direct personal intervention from Mr. Birla. So Srila Prabhupada said, Krishna is like that. He is controlling everything. He simply desires, let there be a universe. And he doesn't have to work to create that universe. He has assistants that do that, like Lord Brahma and the different demigods who actually carry out the work. But his way of working is very, very subtle. You know, like Srila Prabhupada would give the example, Krishna is manifesting millions of flowers. You know, we may try to paint a nice flower, and it takes us, you know, we have to get a brush and some paint, and but every day Krishna is manifesting beautiful flowers. And then Srila Prabhupada would say, you might say, well, I can't see him doing it. He said, well, that's how subtle Krishna is, that he's able to use his energies to manifest all these things practically, so it appears that it's happening automatically. But Srila Prabhupada, that would be a mistake to think that it's happening automatically. There's some brain behind it. So I'll stop there. And I went a little bit over time, so we'll just stop here. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.